Good morning, everyone, and happy Monday. Thank you so much for joining me today. I was really hoping to be outdoors. You saw the beautiful thumbnail there with me in front of the urban raised bed with the beautiful flowers and Mac in the background. He showed up just in time for the photo. But it started blowing again this morning outside, and it's just too loud and too windy. Everything blows all over the place. If I try and live stream outside, you guys would not be able to hear me. But the cool thing is, I'm able to be inside, able to be with you guys, and start my Monday off with all of you wonderful people here in the chat. And we are expecting a lot of rain this week, so I'm really excited about that. If you guys watched our camera guy, and I actually filmed two videos this past weekend, it was really fun. We got outside to film a wind aftermath, and you saw how it was like laying down seeds however I could to get ready for the rain. That way, the rain does all the work for me. So hopefully the rain will bring up the seeds there and just help make the garden green. So if you're in SoCal, we are getting about 2 weeks of rain, which we desperately, desperately need, and I'm very excited about that. So thank you so much for taking time out of your Monday to join me here. It is going to be a really fun live stream. I know a lot of you are already starting your seeds indoors, and I thought I would do a stream on six mistakes to avoid when you're starting seeds indoors, so you guys can get started on the right foot and avoid a lot of the mistakes that I've made in the past and have strong, healthy seedlings to pop outside as soon as the weather is warm enough in your area. So before we dig into that, I just want to say hi to those of you who are here in the chat already. I really appreciate you showing up in the chat a little bit early. We stream every Monday here at noon Pacific time in case you're new. I'm always in the chat about 15 minutes early. Nisha and Cliff, our moderators, are usually in the chat about a half an hour early. So if you have the time, come on and join us. We'd love to hang out beforehand, get to know each other. It's a really fun community here. We love to provide a lot of garden support for each other. And there's lots of ideas out there thrown around. I'm not the only one here offering up tips and suggestions. A lot of you are great, wonderful participants and have gotten to be friends over the past couple of years we've been live streaming. So let me just greet some of you. If you're new to our live stream, please say hello. Let us know where you're streaming from. And we're very happy that you're here. Richard Walkup from North Carolina. I don't think I remember you being here before, Richard. So thank you so much for joining us. Terry is here. I am not far from you, and I planted some more lettuce outside like you did since we're getting rain. Great idea, Terry. You're gonna have to let me know how that works for you. I absolutely love doing that. It saves me so much time and really gives me a head start on the garden. And it's always fun to see the seeds come up when I really didn't do anything but go out there and spread them around. Chris Brandman is watching from Long Island. I bet it's nice and cold, or maybe not nice and cold, but very cold out there in Long Island, Chris. So hopefully we'll be able to send some of our Southern California sunshine your way. Patsella is here. Hi, Patsella. How are you doing? She's been on our live streams a regular for years. So thank you so much, Patsella. Melissa, how are you? I said hello to you earlier in the chat, so I'm so glad that you're here. Melissa was actually mentioning that she's been having a tough time with her seed startings, and I told her that she's in the right place. We've got solutions for your seed starting problem. So thanks a lot for joining us, Melissa, and just taking the time out to educate yourself and do your own research. Victoria, also watching from Long Island. We have a lot of Long Island gardeners here. So that would be really cool if you guys somehow, I know it's COVID, but somehow got together. I guess we're all getting together here on the live stream and shared your gardening tips for Long Island. Anna is here from SoCal. Welcome, Anna. Marie is here from up north. She's usually joins us every week. Chris said it's 36 degrees in Long Island. Wow, that is cold. Renee Miller is here from Sacramento. Finally made it to the live chat. So excited, and I'm excited that you're here today, also, Renee. So you guys, I hope you were able to catch the video yesterday too about the hanging baskets. Three easy vegetables to plant in hanging baskets. I'm telling you guys, I am really excited about the hanging baskets. I've grown in baskets before, but I've never really had a lot of luck. They've always dried out. The plants have died. I've always grown those coco coir type liners, and they just haven't done well for me. So I've been growing in the smart pots. They're called no coco liners for several months now, to kind of testing them out, really enjoying them. They're so pretty. They have several different colors, and I'm liking the different trellises that I was able to find. And the different spots I'm able to put them in my garden. So if you didn't catch that video, go back and watch it. You're not going to want to miss it. A lot of people think you just grow flowers in baskets, but you can actually grow a ton of different things. So I'd love to hear from you guys some of your favorite fruits, vegetables, herbs that you like to grow in baskets as well. And I can't wait to get some flowers planted also in baskets to kind of pretty up the garden area. So let's jump into seed starting. Now, if you've been gardening for a while, you're probably an old pro at seed starting, but if this is your first time growing a garden, you might not have ever started from seed before, and I want to encourage you to do that because you can save a ton of money starting from seed. The garden transplants, or the transplants you buy at the garden center, are $3 or $4 a piece. They're so expensive, and you can grow your own full complete garden for just a few dollars when you start from seeds. Not only that, you get a ton of variety, lots of colors. You can grow unusual types of vegetables. It takes a little bit more effort, but I think it is well worth it. So let me know if you are an old hand at seed starting, how you like it. If you're a little bit nervous about it, that's okay. Let me know that too. You are in the right place because we're gonna help you avoid making a lot of the mistakes that I've made over the years and help you be successful. So Miriam is saying she's new to gardening, just ordered her grow lights. So looking forward to growing indoors. Thanks for the motivation and wisdom. You are so welcome, Miriam. I'm so glad you're here. Okay, so the first mistake that you don't want to make when you're starting your seeds is starting them too soon. A lot of people, as soon as January 1 hits, Christmas is over, New Year's is over, they're so excited about gardening and they get their seeds started for their spring garden. But it might be too early. Generally speaking, the best time to start your seeds indoors is about 4 to 6 weeks or so before your last frost date. So for you new gardeners, the frost date is kind of the general guidelines put out where you have the last frost in your area. It's kind of an average date, so it's not a hard and fast date, but that's kind of what you want to gauge your seed starting from, because a lot of vegetables that you're going to grow for the spring, you don't want to put outside until after your last frost date because they're frost sensitive. If you get them out there too soon, the soil's not warm enough, the weather's not warm enough, and they're going to die, and you're going to be so disappointed because all your hard work is going to be washed down the drain, or frosted out actually. So there's a calendar, a frost date calculator it's actually called, where you can pop in your zip code if you're here in the US, and I believe it's good for Canada as well. And it will give you the average last frost date for your area. And then you want to back up that date about 6 weeks prior to that. And that's when, generally speaking, is a good time to get most of your seeds started. So if you've started now, like here in California, we haven't gotten a frost this year, and I don't believe we're going to. So if you're a southern gardener in a mild winter climate, you can go ahead and get a lot of those warm weather veggies started inside. But for you northern gardeners where it's a little bit colder, make sure you check that date because your seedlings are usually good for about 4 to 6 weeks inside. Then they really need to get outdoors. They tend to get like too big inside, take up too much space, get a little bit stressed because you usually have them in those small little, you know, small seed starting pellets or containers, and they just aren't going to do as well after that. That being said, there are a lot of vegetables that you can start about 12 weeks ahead of time, or some vegetables. Onions are a great one to start now, pretty much wherever you live. Peppers, you do want to start about 8 to 10 weeks early because they really like to be outside when it's nice and warm. So you need a little bit of extra time. You want to get them outside about 2 weeks after it frosts. That way the soil is a little bit warmer. So just kind of some general guidelines for when to start your seeds. So avoid making that mistake, getting disappointed, and then wondering what to do with all those seedlings that you have inside if it's not quite warm enough to get them outside. So that being said, there's a whole lot more details, you guys, in my book, Organic Gardening for Everyone. Pretty much lay this all out in a couple different chapters, particularly the one on, let's see, with the one on seed starting. Let me just find that. I thought I'd marked it. Okay, yeah, here's a whole chapter on not only the secret to gardening on a budget is starting seeds indoors, but it gives you all of the details. Different ways that you can start seeds indoors. It's all written down for you. I think it's kind of nice to have a written manual. I mean, videos are great. I got a ton of videos on how to start seeds indoors that you can go and check out. Links will be in this video description when it uploads. But something about having a written manual right in front of you that you can refer to. It tells you all about how to start seeds indoors, how to get your grow light set up, which we're going to cover in just a moment, and gives you tons and tons of information. So if you are a new gardener and you do not have this book, you've got to go right over to CaliKimGardeningHome.com, pick up a signed copy. You can grab it on Amazon, grab it on lots of different online sources, but when you get it from my website, it comes personalized just to you and signed just to you. And you get this free bookmark, which is pretty cool. It's got a little QR code on the back there. And you guys, you got to save yourself some money here. If you want to start from seeds and don't have seeds, I want to invite you to garden along with me. I've got 22 seed collections on my website that take the guesswork out of it for you. So if you're a new gardener, this is a no-brainer. You get the Spring Garden Seed Collection, 13 varieties. And when you buy it with the book, I have them bundled on my website with various seed collections and with the book, you can save $5. So it's a really good deal. And it'll get you started for pennies on the dollar as opposed to what you'd buy transplants for. So make sure you grab these and get yourself some seeds started. You will be so glad you did. It's so rewarding. There's just something about seeing a seed that you plant, that you planted for a beautiful colored tomato. Maybe it's a purple tomato, a green tomato, a yellow tomato. And then seeing it grow inside, that's so rewarding. And then taking it outside when the weather is right, planting it, and then harvesting it. It is a one-of-a-kind satisfaction. And I know those of you who've done it before will absolutely, positively agree with me. So let me hop back in the chat here and see what comments you guys are posting. Let me know what your seed starting struggles are and your seed starting tips. Okay, there's a question here from Carfa Peace. How many hours per day would you say is proper for starting seedlings underneath grow lights? Okay, great question. And that's all covered in my book as well. And you're also gonna wanna watch my grow light setup video, which we're gonna talk more about in just a moment. But what I like to do just kind of as a general rule is leave my grow lights on for 18 hours a day and then off for 6 hours a day. That's what I find works well for me. And I have a timer and I set it all up on a timer. That way I don't have to forget about it. That way I can forget about it and not worry about turning my lights on and off. Okay, here's a comment from Barb. Doing more seed starting this year with your great tips, Kim. My last frost date for me is May 15th in Indiana in zone 5. Barb, I am so happy that you're starting from seed. You are gonna absolutely, positively love it. And I know it might seem like a long time to wait till May. Did you say May or March? I think you said May. In Indiana, it's probably May. That must seem like a long ways away. So you can't really start seeds indoors until April or so. What I would encourage you to do, if you are itching and chomping at the bit to get your seeds started indoors, don't think that you can't grow right now. Grow an indoor garden. Go back and watch that indoor garden series. We posted maybe 5 or 6 videos on how to grow easy crops indoors, including this beautiful little tiny Tim tomato. I'm loving these tomatoes, guys, including lettuce, including microgreens and herbs. You can have yourself a beautiful indoor garden. Kind of scratch that gardening itch during the winter. Until you can get outside and then still have some fresh things to harvest. So you can grab these lovely, I love these little cute 1 gallon smart pots over on my website as well, along with the indoor garden seed collection, which again takes the guesswork out of it. So you don't have to worry what vegetables will grow inside. Where do I get the seeds? We've got you covered. So highly encourage you to do that. So Travis is saying kale. I love kale. Absolutely. I do too. I just planted some more over the weekend, and I really cannot wait to see it sprout. I like to put it in my smoothies. We love kale salads, and it's such a healthy green for you as well, and very, very easy to grow. Carol, a great question here. Never had success with cilantro from seed. Any suggestions? Okay, Carol, don't feel bad. That is one that's a little bit tricky to grow from seed. Go back and watch the herb garden video. I think we posted that sometime in the fall. I give a little tip in there. It is a cool weather herb, so it definitely likes cooler temperatures under 75 degrees. And you know that hard outer shell that cilantro seeds have? What you wanna do is take your seeds, put them on like a hard surface, roll over them with a rolling pin or a glass or something that's hard, squish them with a rock, whatever, to break that hard outer shell, and that will help speed up the germination. Or you can soak the seeds overnight to soften that hard outer shell. But be patient with cilantro. It takes usually a couple of weeks to germinate, and it does need cooler temperatures. So I have to do a little update on my herb garden because my cilantro has germinated beautifully and is growing absolutely lovely. loves the rain, loves the cooler temperatures, and we've been snipping from it quite often. Okay, let's jump into the, oh, let me show you guys. I brought this up to show you guys today from the downstairs under the grow lights. This is a little pot of lettuce. I actually just had a little handful of lettuce seeds. I was going through some of my seeds and some of them spilled on the counter. Happened to have one of these things sitting on my counter with soil in it that I just harvested all the lettuce from. So I just threw them in here. It was maybe 5 days ago and they're already just popping up. I just threw the seeds down, pressed them into the soil. That's how easy it is to grow lettuce. And here they are just popping up for me right here. And I don't even think, I think I probably forgot to put them under grow light. So they're looking a little bit leggy, but we'll fix that problem and get them growing very well. Okay, let's jump into the second mistake that you want to avoid. We have six to get through, so we got to get to moving here. Let's see here. Mistake number two is a very easy one to make, even for seasoned gardeners, and that is planting seeds too deep. The general rule, seeds have different needs, and the general rule of planting, general rule of thumb for planting, is you want to plant your seeds about 2 to 3 times, plant them to the depth about 2 to 3 times the width of the seed. For example, I grabbed myself a little watermelon seed today. Hopefully you guys can see that. That's maybe 1/4 of an inch or so big. This is the, I think it's one of the seeds from the watermelon seed collection. So you want to plant a watermelon seed maybe 1 inch or so deep because you want to have it nice and covered with soil, and that way it can just push up through the soil and it will grow for you just beautifully. But if you plant it 3 or 4 inches deep, it's going to take not only a long time to germinate, but it might not quite have enough energy in this little seed to push its way up through the soil. Now, teeny tiny seeds such as, let me grab one here from the Spring Garden Seed Collection. Such as, that window is putting a real bright light on my face. I'm going to scooch over just a tad here. Okay, here's a good one. These lettuce seeds. Now, these are teeny tiny seeds. Lettuce actually needs light to germinate. So you don't even have to cover it with soil. You just sprinkle the seeds over the soil and then just tamp them down. That's all you have to do for lettuce. So another tiny seed would be, oh, pepper seeds are perfect here. These are very, very small, and I want to say maybe 1/16 of an inch or so. So these you only want to plant maybe 1/8 of an inch deep, maybe even not quite that deep, just barely cover them with soil. Again, if you plant them 2 to 4 inches deep, these little seeds are just not going to have the energy they need to push the seedlings up through the soil. You might not even ever see germination, or it might take them very, very long to germinate. So do make sure you kind of stick to that general rule of thumb and don't plant your seeds too deep, and you should have really good germination with that method. So let me hear from you guys here in the chat if you've ever had that experience of planting your seeds too deep, and hopefully this little tip can help you avoid that mistake and help you have better germination rate with your seeds. So first mistake to avoid is, let me look back at my notes here, is starting your seeds too soon. Second mistake to avoid is don't plant your seeds too deep. Okay, let's head back in the chat here. Okay, Yvonne is saying, oh my goodness, I think I planted mine too deep, all my peppers. Well, you know what, Yvonne, it's not too late. You can always start a new tray, or I mean, I always like to have backups. If you are really concerned that you might have planted them way too deep, then I would definitely start a brand new tray. And I was going to talk about this in just a moment here, but we'll throw this in now. With pepper seeds, you guys, they like that bottom heat to germinate. So grab yourself a heat mat, save yourself a ton of trouble, and that will help your pepper seeds germinate a lot quicker than if you don't use a heat mat. And Ultimate Gardening is here. Hello, how are you doing today? And Ultimate Gardening is saying, I started seeds now because they grow earlier than any other state, because here in Florida, by the end of January, we start to heat up again. I'm planning to do more seed videos. That's great. Glad to hear that. Southern gardeners definitely have that benefit of getting our seeds started very, very soon. So way to go there, getting out there and doing the work. I bet you're super, super excited. And Nicholas says, I grew super hot peppers 1/4 inch deep. That's probably just about the right depth for pepper seeds, and they grew perfectly. So great tip there. Thank you so much. Okay, how can you avoid legginess for seedlings in a grow light box from Fresh Landscape? How are you doing? Great to have you here today. We're going to actually talk about that in just a moment. So we will hold on to that. All the leggy seedling questions we'll hold on to and answer them in just a moment. So here's a question from Chris. Growing your herb collection in the window, chives and basil are very slow growing. Have to take a picture and show you that I have a green basil growing with a purple basil. I think I'm lucky. That's awesome, Chris. So maybe one of those little green basil seeds got mixed up in there. Something to kind of consider there, Chris, is that your window, I'm not sure where you live, but your window might be a little bit chilly, especially for the basil. It really likes the warmer temperatures. I know mine did not do super well growing in my living room under the grow light. It was just a little bit chilly in our house. We've been getting nights in the 40s. We don't often run our heater at night because I don't like the hot, dry air. So it's just a little bit chilly for that. It's going to do better if you put it in a warmer location. But be patient. Hang in there. It sounds like you've got some coming up. So hopefully you're going to have some fresh basil to eat very soon. And thank you so much for growing with my herb seed collection. Very grateful for you. Okay, so let's jump into mistake number three, which a lot of you have already been talking about here with peppers, and that is growing your seeds at the wrong temperature, which I just talked about with basil as well. So for a lot of you that are new, you might not be aware that there are different types of vegetables. Different types of seeds, again, have different needs. We have cool weather vegetables, which grow best at temperatures between or under 75. A lot of those will even take a light frost. So some of those you can get planted outside as your temperatures kind of start warming up in the spring. Even before your frost date, you can get peas planted. You might want to go out there and sprinkle down some lettuce seeds. There's lots of really early crops that you can plant. And then besides your cool weather vegetables, you have your warm weather vegetables, your tomatoes, your cucumbers, your eggplants, all those beautiful vegetables that we typically grow in the summertime. And different vegetables need different temperatures. So if you're growing broccoli indoors and you put them in a place where it's 80 degrees, most likely that those broccoli seeds are not going to germinate, or they will germinate very, very slowly. So on my seed packets from my spring garden seed collection, I tried to put it on all my seed collections. It does say the temperatures. These are all what you get in the spring garden seed collection. I generally try and put on there if they're a warmer the veggie and what temperature they grow best at. This one happens to be golden summer crookneck squash. It says warmer the veggie 60 to 85 degrees Fahrenheit, and when to start your seeds about 4 weeks before your last frost date. So do make sure you read the directions on the seed packet. That will definitely help you out. And you might have to make some adjustments to your indoor grow light stations based on the types of seeds that you're growing. So definitely starting your seeds at the wrong temperature can inhibit their growth. I mentioned peppers need a heat mat to germinate, or they don't need a heat mat, but it definitely does help speed up the germination process. They can take 2 to 3, sometimes even up to 4 weeks to germinate if they're, you know, like the hot peppers take a little bit longer. So I don't know about you guys, but I get pretty impatient when it comes to seed starting, and I like to get things moving along. So peppers and eggplant really benefit from a heat mat. It just helps warm up that heat tray or that seed tray a little bit to help pop those seedlings through. And I even like to use a heat mat for my tomatoes and cucumbers and other warm weather vegetables just to get them off to a really fast start. So if you're not sure which vegetables are cool weather and which vegetables are warm weather, again, I got that all covered for you in my book, a whole big list on what you can expect as far as cool weather and warm weather vegetables. So right here for you as a resource. And also, you guys, go back and watch the Spring Garden series from the past couple of years. There's lots of good information in those videos on seed starting, how to start seeds, mistakes to avoid, easy ways, cheap and expensive ways to get seed started, how to get your grow light set up, watering, fertilizing. We really try and get all the resources out there so that you guys are successful in whatever you do. So definitely don't make the mistake that I've made many a time and the wrong temperature. I start my cool weather seeds in 80 degrees and it just doesn't work. Now, I do want to encourage you guys, if you do make mistakes, because expect it, we all do, don't give up. They are just, look at them not as failures, but as learning experiences, and learn from your mistakes and just move on and try again and make some adjustments. Okay, from Lilla. Hi, Lilla. I was talking to you earlier in the chat. I'm so glad that you're here. Really appreciate all your positive comments on YouTube. Appreciate you watching our videos and for all of your support. And Lila's saying, I got the melon and squash seeds. Wow, thank you. As well as the indoor gardening seeds and the colorful smart pots. That's awesome. Thank you so much for your support. My 6-year-old is going to be super excited about the mandarin orange color. He loves the color. Lila, I'm so glad to hear that. My desire and my hope is that kids will really get into gardening. And one reason why I went ahead and had smart pots designed and put my logo on their smaller pots, because I wanted to make it easily accessible for indoor gardening and for kids. It's the perfect kid size, don't you think? And it's bright and cheery and brightens up your garden. And I really hope that your 6-year-old loves it. Please drop me a line. You can email me at calliekim@calliekimgardeninghome.com and let me know what you're going to be growing and how your son or daughter enjoys the indoor or the smart pots. Very fun. Okay, let's see here. Any other comments about seed starting? Let's see here. Okay. I don't see any. Oh, here's one from Chini. Haven't seen you for a while, Chini. Glad that you're back. I tried to grow some vegetables on a screened-in patio, but nothing was pollinated. How do I fix this? Well, there are some things that you can hand pollinate. The squash and melon are super easy to hand pollinate. With tomatoes, all you have to do is kind of shake your. I don't know if this one's flowering yet. Oh, I do have a couple flowers on here. With tomatoes, it's a self-pollinating vegetable, which means all you have to do is kind of shake your tomato pot to move the pollen around, and that will help pollinate the tomatoes. But any other vegetables that you might be growing inside might have to be pollinated by hand, or maybe you want to take them out during the day, bring them in at night. That's an option for you. If it's too cold at night, then maybe that'll help get you some more vegetables. Okay, my backyard gourds, how are you? I'm having a hard time getting beets. What can I do? I get a lot of leaves, but no veggies. Okay, my backyard gourds, beets, if they are grown in too hot of temperatures, that's one of the issues, is that they'll produce a lot of leaves, but not the beets. So if they got a little bit stressed out, maybe you started them when it was hot and put them outside, they got a little bit stressed out. You might have to start a new batch in the cooler temperatures, and that might help. So hopefully that will help get you some new beets. Now, if you do want to grow for the beet roots, don't harvest the leaves until you get the beet roots growing, a nice bulb growing as a beet, because they do need those leaves in order to produce. And if you keep harvesting the leaves, they might not produce the beet. So give it another try, and then let me know how it works for you, okay? Okay, let's jump back into mistake number 4, and this is such a common one. I don't know how many times I've done this just out of forgetting, but mistake number 4 is not enough light, not giving your seedlings enough light. And that is probably one of the biggest mistakes that new gardeners make. And I grew seeds in front of my sunny window for a couple of years when I first started gardening, and it does work. If that's your only option, definitely do that. But the bottom line is that oftentimes we just don't have enough light, even if we have a south-facing window, to grow strong, healthy seedlings. So you're going to have a lot more luck if you invest in some grow lights and get your seedlings that nice overhead direct light that they need in order to grow nice and strong and healthy. So a lot of times, if you have them too far away from the light, they get a little bit leggy. These are just popping up, and they're tad bit leggy, but not too bad. I just had them on my countertop. I don't know if you guys can see that. But if I continued to just let this sit on my countertop, what they would do is just develop small, kind of thin stems. And you want your stems to be nice and strong and stocky, because once you put them outside, they're going to get blown around. They're going to be out in the elements, and you want them to be able to stand strong and be healthy and not get attacked by pests. If they do get attacked, you want them to survive. So do yourself a favor and invest in some grow lights. However, that being said, don't think that grow lights have to be super expensive. There's tons of expensive ones out there on the market that work great, but you can get one started for probably under $20. Go back and watch my grow light video. I did bring up my grow light box today. I don't know if you guys are going to be able to see this, but this is basically a big 30-gallon, I think it's 30-gallon storage tub. It's got a hole cut in the top of the lid. Let me just pull the lid off so you guys can see. It's a really good way to start your seeds if you're new, if you have pets that are going to get into things, or kids that might get into things and dump your seedlings over. And it just has a little clamp light attached to the top of the lid here. And then you just set your lid on top of your bin, put your little seed tray in it, and the key to not getting leggy plants is to put your little seedling containers no more than about 3 inches away. Let me get this in frame here. About 3 inches away from your light. So if your light is way down here, if your light is way up here and your seed pot is at 6 inches or more, your little seedlings are going to have to stretch, and that's what's going to make them leggy. So avoid that mistake. Do yourself a favor. This is probably, I don't know, the bins are what, maybe $6, $7, $8. And then this little grow light clamp light to set up might be around $10. You do need an extra grow light bulb, but go back and watch that video, and all the links are there in the video description, so you don't have to hunt around trying to figure out which grow light bulbs are right for you, which grow light bulbs work and don't work. I've done the work for you, and it's all there right for you to get started. And also in my book, so you can have it all written down for you. No excuses, you guys, right? You can have seedlings that aren't leggy. So not enough light is one reason for leggy seedlings. The other reason is that maybe you're planting too many seedlings in one spot and they're kind of competing for the light. So I usually do that with lettuce because I just sprinkle my seedlings in. So you might have to go in there and thin things out so it's kind of evenly distributed. But if you do have leggy seedlings, what I like to do is just plant them a little bit deeper in the soil to kind of give them a little extra support. Once you transplant them, you can just pop them a little bit deeper in your soil here. Tomato seedlings are a great way to do this. You can actually add more soil here to give them a little bit more support. This one needs some more soil to help them grow more roots from the stem. Lettuce seedlings work really well that way too. So hopefully those little tips will help you avoid leggy seedlings. So when you're ready to plant outside, your seedlings will be nice and strong. Okay, let me jump back in the chat, see what other questions you guys have. Oh, I'm sorry, Velma, how many hours a day? That grow light video will answer all your questions, but 18 hours a day on, 6 hours a day off, and all the directions are also written down in my book, Organic Gardening for Everyone. So do yourself a favor, watch the video, grab a copy of my book at calliekimgardeninghome.com so you have all the resources you need. That's what we're all about here, is providing tons of resources. Okay, here's a good question from Nurse Lenny. How would I transfer the peat pellets into my smart pots to be outside? Okay, Nurse Lenny, you want to go and watch the video in our spring garden series called Transplanting Indoor Seedlings to the Outdoors. That's going to answer a lot of your questions. Super easy. All you have to do is peel the netting off of your peat pellets and you just pop them out in your smart pots. That's all there is to it. You can dig a little hole. Actually, what you might want to do is go back and watch the container garden series. That does have some specific videos on how to transplant into smart pots. But you would just kind of dig a little hole in the soil here with your hand, pop your peat pellet in, cover it up with soil, and you are good to go. Super easy. But you do want to make sure that you harden off your seedlings. You don't want to take them directly from inside to the outside. So go back, watch the spring garden series, watch the container garden series. Grab my book. There's all those resources out there to help you, but it's very, very easy. So, again, if you make mistakes, no big deal. You just plant some more and learn from your mistakes for next time. You're welcome, Nurse Lenny. Thank you so much for the question. Okay, so let's see here. Mistake number five. Again, one of the most common mistakes is too little or too much water. So try and avoid the inclination that most all of us gardeners have of overwatering. That's probably my biggest temptation. I don't often underwater. Sometimes I do, I might forget, but usually I overwater. So of course, underwatering, even if you let your little containers or pellets dry out, even one time, it can really stunt your plant. So do try and check your plants daily to see if they need water. So, in my book, I cover watering in depth, including three clues on how to tell if your seedlings need water. The color of the soil, you always want to check the soil with your finger to see if it's wet. And you can tell by how light or how heavy your seedling container is. If it's too light, then that means it probably needs more moisture. Now, the other thing is you don't want to completely dripping wet soak your plants. It should be moist. Not overly waterlogged, because if your seedlings are too wet, it can cause all kinds of fungal diseases, can bring in mold, you can get fungus gnats, can cause damping off where you get sudden death of your seedlings. We definitely don't want that. So one thing that I like to do is water from the bottom. For example, I'll pour water in the bottom of my seedling tray or in the bottom of my little indoor container here in my saucer, and then let the plant kind of wick up the water from the bottom, and you leave it in there for about 30 minutes or so. When the top of the soil changes to a darker brown, that means you've got enough water in there, moisture content in your soil, and you can dump the extra water out or use it for another plant. So it definitely does take, you know, a little bit of extra time, but again, it's well worth it for growing all the beautiful colors and varieties that you can grow when you start from seed. So go back and watch the watering and fertilizing video from the Spring Garden series from last year, and it will give you all the tips. And they're all in my book as well, written down for you. Okay, let's see here. I'm so sorry. Zach, could I just call you Zach? I'm sorry. Callie Kim, that's so true. I truly learned that from your videos. Awesome sauce. I love that. Thank you so much. I'm glad that you're learning from the videos. Wonderful. Okay, let's see here. Oops. Any other questions here in the chat? Jocelyn, how are you? I want to know if it's too late to plant garlic in my garden. I live in San Diego, California, and the temperature has been in the 60s. It's been rainy and windy here. I hear you, Jocelyn. It's been the same here in where I live too. So I think we're about the same temperature. You know what? Garlic actually does best if you plant it a little bit earlier, but go for it. I've planted garlic in January before. It's a little bit difficult here in Southern California to get nice big garlic bulbs because it likes that kind of winter chill to and the dormant period to kind of develop big bulbs. But it'll take you about 6 months for your garlic to be ready to harvest. You might not get big bulbs, but you will still get some garlic, so go for it. I've got a video on how to grow garlic in a warm climate. So make sure you go back and watch that. And Melissa is saying, I think I have those little gnats. Those things are so darn pesky. And one thing I have had so much success with this year is the little yellow sticky traps. Oh, here they are. I love these, you guys. They have ones that are shaped like flowers, butterflies, I think all kinds of different things. And this might even have some of those little fungus gnats on them. And honestly, I haven't had a big problem with them this year because these things have been catching all of them. And the neem oil really helps as well. Okay, I think we do have one more mistake to get through, and then we're gonna hang out in the chat for a little bit and answer a lot of your questions. So the last one, guys, and this is probably one that, I don't know, maybe a lot of you are making right now or have made in the past, is giving up too early. So a lot of times when we jump into gardening, we tend to jump in really fast. We're so excited about it. We plant a ton of stuff, we get overwhelmed, and then things die, we just can't keep up with it, and we say, this is not for me, I'm giving up, I have a brown thumb. But my philosophy is, there are no brown thumbs, everybody has a green thumb. My motto is, start simple and expand later, don't give up. So just start with one or two vegetables that you like to eat, start with those, get some confidence, get some new skills. And then you're going to get so excited when you taste your first homegrown salad that you're going to want to expand your garden and grow more. So do yourself a favor, start simple, and then don't give up if you do make mistakes. Like I said earlier, we've been there. We've all made mistakes if we're honest with each other and with ourselves. Don't feel like you failed. Just learn from your mistakes, adjust it. Gardening is different for everyone. Make the adjustments and then always plant a few extra seedlings in case things do die. Expect the challenges and then you won't be so disappointed. And then join in a gardening community. Join us here on Mondays. Watch our YouTube videos. Go join Gardening Coast to Coast over on Facebook. Chat with other gardeners in your area. Garden with your family. Get a garden buddy so that you can compare notes and give each other support. But don't give up. That's the biggest thing is. Gardening is a lifestyle. It's so rewarding. Every time you put that plate of fresh vegetables on the table, I'm telling you guys, it is worth the effort. So I hope that these videos were helpful for, or these videos, these mistakes to avoid were helpful for you guys. Let's just go back and review real quick. Starting your seeds too soon, don't make that mistake. Planting your seeds too deep, the wrong temperature, not enough light, too little or too much water, and don't give up. And again, these are all covered in more depth in my book and in a lot of our spring garden series. So make sure you go back and review all the resources that are out there for you, and you are sure to be successful with your garden. And I also wanted to let you guys know is that if you are wanting to get supplies to get going with your garden, always check the video descriptions. We put a ton of links in there to Amazon, to different resources all over the internet, to the Farmer's Almanac, all that kind of stuff. The video descriptions are a treasure trove of information. I've been there. I've tried all those products. The ones I link up to are ones that work. So I do not want you to go out there and waste your money. So we've got tons of resources for you on our website, all the seed collections, the books, the smart pots, lots of stuff out there to help you be successful in your garden experience. So let's jump here back in the chat, answer some of your questions, and let me know what tips you have for seed starting as well. I would love to hear from those as well. Okay, thank you so much, Veronese. I'm still learning and I don't think I would ever stop. Kim's videos have helped me a lot. Thank you, Kim. You're so welcome, Veronese. I'm so glad you're with us on this gardening journey. You've really come a long way and I'm very, very proud of you and I appreciate all of your support as well. Oh, here's a comment from Omar. Omar, thank you so much for hanging out here today. My seedlings are growing so well. I have watermelon and too much fruits and vegetables that my family will eat. Thanks, Cali Kim, for all the support. Great to hear, Omar. That's a really good problem to have. And I bet you can give away some of those vegetables to some of your friends and maybe help them get interested in gardening as well. Okay, from Randy Ramirez. I gave up on a zinnia seedling and just stuck it into the ground and it ended up being my most prolific zinnia. I was blown away. Isn't that crazy? It's funny how nature sometimes has a way of winning out. We tend to sometimes overdo it. I know I do. I overlove plants, overlove seedlings, and then when I ignore them, they end up doing just fine. Okay, I saw a question here of when will my new book come out? Good question. For those of you who don't know, I am writing a second book. Well into the writing process. We even did a photo shoot on Friday, our first photo shoot for the new book. Super excited about it. Actually, a little behind the scenes story. My daughter, Jules, is shooting the photos for the book. She's an awesome photographer. And we were shooting a photo and there was a brick on the edge of our fountain planter and it fell off and fell smack on my foot. And I literally thought I was gonna go out of my mind. It hurt so stinking bad. I was doubled over in pain. And my foot swelled up like a balloon. I did not break my toe, but it's swollen up and black and blue. It fell right on my big toe. And I've been kind of hobbling around the house on it. And if you guys noticed in both of our videos this weekend, I had my red rain boots on, which it was raining. But I was very grateful because those are big boots and I could actually put my foot into those. So pray for me that we don't have any more accidents on our photo shoots. Yeah, it hurt really bad. I had to actually put ice on it and everything on Friday night. But anyway, the new book will be coming out sometime in the spring of 2022. We're kind of keeping the topic a surprise for now. So we'll probably release that as we get later into the summertime. But we're jumping into it and super excited about it. I know you guys are going to absolutely love it. And I cannot wait to be able to share more with you. Okay, thank you so much for all your well wishes. Thank you, Nora. Yeah, it was pretty crazy. I didn't think it would hurt that bad, but it really did. Thank you. It's actually feeling a lot better today. It's pretty black and blue and kind of ugly. And I'm actually wearing my slippers around the house today because, you know, I work at home, so it's really fun to be able to do that. It's raining outside or going to be raining, so I don't have to go outdoors just now. But if I do, I can slip on those red rain boots. Thank you. Okay, let's see here. Rudimental Gardening is trying out a new seed starting mix with two parts peat moss and one part vermiculite. So far, so good. A very light and friable mix for young seedlings. Thank you so much for sharing that, Rudimental Gardening. It's great to hear about different ways that people are growing seedlings and how we can save a little bit of money as well. I love to add some worm castings to my seedling mix that I make myself. That really helps kind of speed things along. Gives them a little bit of extra oomph. To be fertilized in their growing process. Okay, yes, Rochelle, I got my sticky traps from Amazon as well. And I think I probably have a link in the video description of this video when it uploads, but I'll try and pop that in if I haven't. And they're really quite inexpensive. Okay, from God's servant, I have a 4 foot tall Tabasco pepper that is not producing. Any way to save it and get it to produce? Or shall I start over? Okay, God's servant, I'm not sure where you live, but I know in California it's pretty cold. I mean, it's not super cold, but it's a little bit too cold for peppers to really be all full on producing. I'm getting a few little peppers here and there, but peppers like the heat. They like temperatures of 80, 90 degrees. They do really well in hot temperatures. So it could just be it's a little bit chilly for it where you live. You can prune them back, mulch them over the winter time, especially in mild climates. That works really well, mild winter climates. And then as soon as the temperatures warm up, it'll probably start taking off again. So hopefully that'll work for you. I wouldn't give up on it. If you live in a cold climate, you might want to dig it up, prune it, go back and watch my overwintering pepper video for all the details. And then you can pop it back outside when the temperatures warm up. So peppers are super, super hardy. Okay, aspen bean blossom. What's the best soil for raised garden beds? There are so many different soils out there on the market. The bagged soils, there's a lot of great bagged ones, but it does tend to be an expensive way to fill a raised bed. I like to buy soil in bulk for my raised beds. You can check around. A lot of times your local landscape companies will have organic, like a veggie mix type soil, and I usually add more compost to it to kind of amend it. So check around to your local companies and see if they might have something available for you. You can save a lot of money that way. Or you can also make your own mix out of coco coir, worm castings. There's tons of really good, recipe videos out there. So just do a couple of research, do some research. I know there's one called Mel's Mix that works really well. There's another one, I can't recall the name of it, but we're hoping to do a video on making your own soil in the Spring Garden series. So definitely stay tuned for that. Okay, here's another question from Nurse Levy. Which, for Calikin pots, which size is good for what herbs and veggies? I bought them all sizes in a set of three. Can the big purple one do carrots, cucumbers, and green peppers? Okay, Nurse Levy, yes, it can. So thanks again for purchasing my smart pots. The purple ones, let me grab a purple one. These ones have, I think, 13 gallons, but they're about 3 square feet of growing space. Go back and watch the container garden series. That'll give you some more details. This one is perfect for, I think you said peppers, carrots. You could grow cucumbers in it. It's a little bit shallow for tomatoes unless it's a dwarf tomato. And so that would work really well for smaller types of vegetables. Works perfect for greens, perfect for radishes, for lettuce, anything like that. The 1 gallons will be great again for greens, for microgreens. Even you can use these to transplant your vegetables in. So once your seedlings in peat pellets get a little bit too big, you can transplant them into the 1 gallons. These are perfect for microgreens. The 5 gallons, like are right here, are great for peppers as well, for cucumbers, for peas. I would not do a full-size tomato in the 5 gallons, but you can plant just about anything else except the larger type of vegetables. I would definitely stick with more compact vegetables like I have in the container garden seed collection. You can plant most of those in a 5 gallon or in the purple one. So that would be a good way for you to go. All right, a couple more questions here before we sign off. I've heard asparagus grows wild. This is from Zach. Should I plant in my garden bed or containers? If a container, what size? Okay. I would do asparagus can get quite large. So I would do not asparagus. I'm thinking artichokes. I've actually never grown asparagus before, so I really can't speak to with a lot of authority on that. So if anyone here in the chat has grown asparagus, maybe you could help her out. That would be really nice. Hi, Connie Graham. How are you? Besides being pretty, nasturtiums are helpful in gardens, luring aphids away from vegetables. Can I start seeds indoors? And what temperature do they need to germinate and grow? Thank you. Okay, Connie. Nasturtiums, honestly, yes, you can start them indoors, but you honestly don't need to. They are frost sensitive. So you want to wait until after your last frost. They'll die if they get frost. But they grow so, so fast. They are a cool weather flower. And you're absolutely right. They're kind of like, they can be like a trap crop to trap the pesky aphids and other pests, that's what the word I'm trying to think of, from infesting your other crops. So they're great to use for that way. But they do like cooler temperatures, which Connie, I believe you're up in the Pacific Northwest, so you can probably grow them all summer there. They really will do best in temperatures under 80 degrees. They're gonna bloom like crazy when they're in full sun at cool temperatures. Love, love, love lots of rain. So I'm really hoping my nasturtiums really start popping with all this rain we're having. So hopefully that will help. Question here from Jetrick777. What size pot for a regular size tomato? I would totally go with at least a 10 gallon, 20 gallon is probably a little bit better to give the roots more space. And by the way, you guys, Smart Pots, hopefully this spring, is coming out with the bright colored larger Smart Pots. So the mandarin orange, the berry blue, and then the purple will be available in the larger sizes this spring. And those are so, so pretty, growing tomatoes, pepper, whatever in them. They just make such a beautiful color splash in your garden, and I think you guys are gonna love it. Lots of great comments here about asparagus. I love this. I love it when you guys jump in and help everybody else out. I'm definitely not an expert in everything, but there's someone out there who is. So thank you guys so much for those of you who are jumping in. That's why I love this community. I know I keep saying that, but it really is fantastic the way everyone helps each other out. Okay, Liz. Hi, Liz. How are you? I'm here for the colored Smart Pots and bigger sizes. Keep an eye out, guys. I'll make sure to let you know when those are available, hopefully coming out soon. I saw a comment here from Lila. I hope I'm saying your name right. Maybe it's Lila. It's probably Lila. I'm trying to make my own compost, but it's taking a while. Yeah, it does take a little bit of time, but you can speed it up if you make hot compost. A lot of times, if you get it nice and heated up, it can break down in 3 to 5 weeks, which is super, super fast. So make sure you go back and watch the compost playlist. All kinds of videos out there to help you. Okay, Hashi, any seed recommendations for a cocktail tomato? I really love Campari tomatoes. Okay, cocktail tomatoes are typically a little bit larger than cherry tomatoes. I mean, honestly, my favorite is the Tiny Tim. It's so easy to grow. It's probably maybe a tiny bit smaller than a cocktail size, but it's a delicious tomato and so productive. And it's a determinate tomato, but the plants last forever. I have a plant outside that looks absolutely terrible. It's been growing for about a year. I even outside in the cold nights, and it still has some tomatoes on it. So surprisingly enough, I know I did grow a cocktail tomato a couple years ago. I believe it's called the Red Racer. Go over and check out All America Selection's website. I don't recall what seed company puts it out, but if you look at All America Selections, it is an All America Selections winner. So you will be able to search that and find it over on their website. Okay, I'm gonna take another question here. Let's see here. Yeah, definitely Faye, hot compost does break down quickly if you can get it hot enough. There's all kinds of tips in that video on how to get it hot. Let's see from Jocelyn. What vegetable plants can I plant right now? And can I start carrots outside? Okay, Jocelyn, it really depends on the temperatures where you live. So if it's a cool weather vegetable or if it's a warm weather vegetable, I always try and give the general principles, and then you have to decide depending on your temperatures, what vegetables are right for you to plant depending on where you live. And I cover all that in my book, all the details in here, and also in the Spring Garden series. So go over, grab a copy of my book if you don't have one, or watch the Spring Garden series for lots of more information. Okay, last question here is, wow, we're having a long stream today. I have 7.5 gallon and 15 gallon grow bags. Could I keep multiple peppers in one of these pots? Trying to use my small space wisely, from Maxillera. Yes, peppers actually like to be grown close together. So you can grow 3 or even 5 peppers did you say a 15 gallon, I think? That would probably be good for 3 to 5 peppers. Go back and watch the Container Garden series. There are so many tips on how to plant in containers. So many people now are growing in containers in an apartment, a balcony, a small space, and you're gonna love that series. I grow in Smart Pots, and there's just tons of tips in there, including, you can see kind of how I do it, how many vegetables I plant and how close together, and I think it'll really help you out, and you're really gonna enjoy that. So you guys, this has been a really fun stream today. I can't believe all the great participation. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with me for an extra 10 or 15 minutes here while we talked about some of the questions that you guys have. Hope you guys enjoyed it as much as I have. Hope you guys have a great week. Be looking for more videos with Camera Guy and I both in them. We're really enjoying kind of the vlog style behind the scenes videos. Let me know if you guys are liking those. We're really having a great time going outside and filming those. They're really casual, more conversational. Go over and check out our video from the weekend. And make sure you follow us on Instagram because we do post a lot of behind the scenes type stuff. I post a lot of updates on what I'm doing in my garden, and Camera Guy has some awesome behind the scenes photos on his Instagram as well. Be watching later on today. We actually were models in a photography shoot for popcorn, pillows, and nuts, all those at once. So we're going to be doing, I'm going to be posting a little behind the scenes from that photo shoot later on today or this evening, and linking up to the Instagram where the real photo will be posted on. So make sure you watch for that. My daughter Jules is doing all kinds of photography for lots of different companies and really a very skilled photographer. And her Instagram is Hoop De Loop. I know there's a dash in there somewhere. I can't remember, but we'll post that. I'll tag to her as well. All right, guys, have a great week. Thanks so much for joining me. Looking forward to seeing you on a video and a live stream real soon. Bye-bye.